Hello everyone, my name is Eyal. I'm managing the marketing and the business development activities in Playscape. And today I'm going to talk about strategies for distributing games on Google Play. And I'm going to wrap things up by providing a few tips and tricks that we have been using in Playscape, and hopefully you can use yourself. But before I start, I do want to say that all the information that I'm going to talk about, all the data that you're going to see here is based on our own experience. So if you have contradicting data, if you have a different point of view, just come to me after the talk and you can tell me how much I was right. But seriously now, I think that we do live in an environment, working in an environment that is changing really fast. And I think that the only way we can keep up with all the major changes is to talk about them. And on a different note, since everything around us is changing so rapidly, I think that we tend to get caught in the day-to-day tasks, and it's hard to keep track on the bigger picture. So instead of talking about marketing tactics and numbers and figures, I want to start by talking about something a little bit different. I want to talk about soccer. I mean, everybody is talking about the World Cup. Why can't we? So I want you to imagine yourself standing in a soccer stadium. And you're standing there, and you're giving a task. And the task is to make everyone listen to what you have to say. What do you do? So one way to go, and that's probably the most obvious approach, is to start making some noise. But the problem with the most obvious approach is that it is the most obvious approach, and some other people that are also fighting for attention might be a little bit louder than you. So games marketing is just a bit like that. And instead of a soccer stadium, you have Google Play. And in Google Play, there are more than 1 million applications. I mean, think about this amazing number for just a second. 1 million applications. If I start playing those applications today, and I'm going to dedicate 5 minutes to try and test each one of those, it's going to take me a decade to use them all. If I plan to sleep, it can take me up to 20 years. So people don't really get excited about new game launches. I mean, nobody is going to open Google Play and say, hey, look, a new game. Games are invisible. And that's why 99% of them disappear. So discovery is a big challenge in the mobile space. And I think that as a result, a lot of game developers resort to using advertisements as the main strategy for distributing their games. The way that every advertising strategy goes as follows. You buy some ads, you make some noise. You use the ads to create distribution. You take the distribution and you generate revenue. You take the profit, you invest it back to ads, and the process goes on and on and on. And the thing is that this strategy does not always work for a few reasons. First of all, going back to the soccer analogy, where some people might have been a little bit louder than you, in the game space, there are other first-tier game publishers like DNA and King.com that have marketing budgets that you probably do not have. So if you want to be able to compete with these guys, you cannot do what they are doing because they will do a much better job than you will. If you want a concrete example from the game space, you can look at two types of games on Google Play. First of all, games that monetize using ads, and other games that monetize using IAPs, in-app purchases, by selling virtual items in their games. Now, although those two categories of games fall within the games category, they are essentially very two different products. So a game that monetizes using ads is going to generate about 2 cents for every daily active user. A game that monetizes using IAPs, and I'm talking about games that are doing an amazing job monetizing their users, can make about 12 cents per day, per daily active user. Now, this is 6 times more. And although it's not 10 times more or 100 times more, it is sometimes the difference between making money and losing money. So if King.com can afford themselves to buy users, and for instance, for $1, and still make a profit, a game that monetizes users using ads is going to lose money for every user they buy. And if you think about it, it also goes back to the nature of the way we think and the way we act when we see ads. So the best example I have is about me buying gummy bears, which I really like. So when I want to buy gummy bears, I'm going to the supermarket, and there's a wide variety of gummy bears. So I don't want to see ads about gummy bears because I don't have a gummy bears problem. I think this is the way people look at ads generally. To be honest, I think that people don't care about ads, but they also don't care about your product. I mean, they simply don't care, at least some of them. We are living in a me world. And I think this is partially because people think that they have way less time than they used to and way more choices. And in a world where people have way too many choices and way too little time, the most obvious thing to do is simply to ignore stuff. So if you want to market your game, you don't want to use mass marketing and talk to all these guys because they have become really good in ignoring your ads. And I think that what we have to do is to find a way, instead of talking to everybody we can, to get our ideas to spread. And it doesn't matter to me if you're running a coffee shop, if you're an artist, or if you're distributing games. I think this stuff applies to everyone, regardless of what they do, and then people who know how to spread their ideas win. Now, in order to do that, I think you have to have two key components. The first one is having good content, and I think that you have to do your proper marketing research in order to find the right content. And you also need to use the right marketing tools in order to get to the core group of users and create the snowball effect. Now, this slide, I think, represents the dynamics between content and marketing. So if people say that content is king, marketing can be queen, and some people will say that she is wearing the pants. However, to market a product, to market an idea or a game that doesn't stand out, that is not unique, that is not remarkable, is always impossible. And I think that everybody that works in marketing is going to tell you the same thing. The thing that's going to decide what gets discussed, what gets downloaded, and possibly what gets purchased, is whether your game is remarkable. And remarkable is a really cool word because we think it means neat, but it also means worth making a remark about. And that's in the essence of getting people to talk about our games. Don't Tap the Right Tile is a remarkable game. For those of you who don't know it, it's a tap-tap revolution game for mobile. What you have to do in the game, you have to touch the black tiles, you have to avoid the white tiles, and if you manage to do it, the game plays music. And the game is beautiful and ugly at the same time, and when it came out to the market, it was the only one of its kind. Dumb Ways to Die is a safety announcement by Metro Trains in Melbourne, Australia. It's a safety announcement, and it got more than 10 million downloads only in Google Play. And you have to trust me when I say they did not invest $10 million in promoting this app. And I think what they did is to gamify the safety, idea of what they wanted to portray, and also they presented in a very graphical but very amusing way the way you can die. Flappy Bird is not a very good game if you look at game practices. I mean, people cannot play it, and even those people who can, they want to smash their device into little pieces after a short while of playing it. But you all know the result of the game. Ninja Chicken is one of the games that we've published in Playscape. It's about a chicken who thinks it's a ninja and lays eggs wherever it goes. And when it came out to the market, people didn't understand whether it's a female chicken or a male chicken or why exactly it lays eggs. But the game stood out and they talked about it. And for us, it was an amazing success. It reached the top of the charts all over the world. Monster Smasher is another game by Playscape, and it had solid gameplay and really nice graphics, but I couldn't market it. So how do we explain when things don't go according to plan? Or even better, when others manage to achieve things that defy the fundamental assumptions? Why some games make it to the top, and other games developed by developers that are better funded and more experienced do not? Why some games are downloaded by millions and millions of players and other games are buried in the landslide. So to be honest, I don't think that a lot of people can really tell and can really explain why some games succeed and some games fail. But I think that if you look at the top of the charts, there's something really clear that is happening. Every month, there's a new game that is hitting the top of the charts. And it's never the best game, it's never the best funded game, it's never the game that has the biggest marketing spends, but those games are there because they're unique, they're fresh, and they provide something new to the target audience. And I think that our industry, in a lot of ways, is led by trends. And this year's collection of games is nothing like next year's. We are working in the fashion business. No matter what game you develop, no matter what genre it is, it's the fashion business. And the thing is that people who work in the fashion business, they know what it's like. But the rest of us, we have to start thinking that way. And we have to realize that it's not about presenting the users with our full page ads, but it's an entirely different process of getting people to talk about our games. Now, you cannot really assure that people will do that, but I think that innovation is key. You can innovate by creating a new concept, like the guise of don't tap the white tile. You can innovate by using a slick design or crazy creatives, like we did with Ninja Chicken. Or you can use technology, and I think that Dirty Beat is doing a really good job with their game Fun Run, which is the first real-time multiplayer runner game for mobile. However, if you think that you're going to launch your game and then people will magically gravitate toward it, you're heading to a surprise. And I think that once you have something that is worth talking about, you have to be able to find the core group of people that will care about your product. And they will listen because it's not about you, it's about them. And if you're lucky enough and if you're doing your job properly, they will talk to their friends and they will talk to their friends and your idea will spread. It will spread to the rest of the curve. At the heart of finding the right people, there's targeted marketing. Now, targeted marketing was not even an option up until a few years ago. I mean, some brands did use the geolocation of the device in order to create targeted campaigns. But to be honest, I think that this option was rarely available, and marketeers had no idea what to do with it anyway. What we're seeing today is that ad networks, they managed to take the geolocation of the device and they translate it into user profiles and segments. So according to where the device lives and the type of people that visit those places, they can draw conclusions and bucket them into demographics, psychographics, and other user profile and segments. And with social media, social networks today, we can even get a better understanding of our users. So the technology is definitely there, and we can use it in order to get to the right people, but now we have to form a strategy around it. So I want to guide you through what we're doing in Playscape and how we launch our games. So I think when we first launched our games to Google Play, it was very important for us to understand how we can enlarge the margin between the money we spend and the money we earn. And in order to do that, we had to learn Google Play and to understand how it works. So here are the few methods that we use in order to lower the user acquisition cost. So first of all, we use targeted marketing. We talked about that. We also use cross-promotion, and cross-promotion is a great way of getting a few downloads at the price of one. So you acquire one user, and then if you have other games, you can cross-promote them to the next game, and generate a few downloads out of it. Using the charts is a great way of getting people to discover your app from looking at Google Play. You have to know exactly how many users you have to drive to your game in order to get to a specific rank, and how many users you have to continue to drive in order to sustain your rank. But if you know how much you have to do and how many you get in return, that's a great way of generating organic traffic. Word of mouth is not something you can rely on, but we definitely have to start thinking that way. If you have a game that is worth talking about, it's important to understand how you communicate it using your marketing assets to your potential players. Search is another great tool. of that can allow you to make your game pop up when people are looking for a specific keyword. So for instance, Ninja Chicken pops up when people are just searching for ninja games, which drives a lot of organic traffic for us. Now, we can't start off by doing search because you have to have a critical mass of downloads even to pop up in keywords that are not very popular. But once you do get that critical mass, that's a great way of scaling up. And of course, there's press. The main thing I want to say about press is that if you're using it as a way for getting users to play your game, you should not use it as a way for getting people to play your game. But it is a great way for getting recognition and to talk to the key decision makers. So if you're looking to form partnership, this is a tool you should definitely consider. So what you see here is a graph that shows the launch of one of our games. And it shows you the exact number of downloads we got every day, from day 1 to day 30. And the color represents a traffic source. So the blue color stands for the organic traffic that we generated. And as you can see in the initial, the first day of the launch, we drove a lot of traffic, but then very fast, we started getting a lot of organic traffic, which means word of mouth, charts, or search. What might be interesting for you to see here is that although we drove a lot of traffic in the beginning, after that, we used specific and very targeted promotional spikes only whenever the game needed the support in order to continue to grow. And that can save you a lot of money if you are able to work that way. Now, it's not an exact science, but it is almost an exact science. And if you want to be able to understand the data and to analyze it, you have to stay data-driven. We invested a lot of resources in creating both the infrastructure and also recruiting the right personnel in the company in order to be able to track the data and to analyze it. And one cannot do without the other. And it allows you not only to operate efficiently in Google Play, but it can also let you do something else that is very important, which is to test everything. Now, I know that a lot of people are talking about A/B testing and how important it is. It's not just a slogan. It really is true. I mean, I wish I had some more time so I can show you the different ads that we are using for the games and how surprising the result can be. But we don't have the time, so you have to trust me. But testing is really important. And I think that if you want to work efficiently, you have to make your assumption, create the respective segments, and then test everything against each other. And another guideline that follows us and that we follow in everything that we do is that we try to remember that marketing does not equal advertising. I mean, advertising is really important. It's an important part of every marketing plan. But I think that sometimes we just tend to forget that there's so much more we can do. And we tend to look at our users as numbers and figures. And I think that the industry is doing an amazing job in dehumanizing our users, calling them whales. It's not only unethical. I think it's also counterproductive and not true. And I think that if you want to be truly successful, we have to go back to basics. And we have to realize that it's not about presenting our users with our full-page ads and grabbing them by the throat, but it's an entirely different process of getting our idea to spread. And people who know how to spread their ideas win. Thank you for listening, and I hope you have a good and fruitful conference. Thank you.